estamos por en Europa, chao. Okay, my name is Bernardo, and I'm talking about my personal story. I immigrated from Brazil to Ireland, and also about being transitioning while working as a software engineer. So, it's all about my personal story, so it's about my personal background. I work mostly with Python, currently I'm working in Symantec in Ireland. I really like Python, I think it's a language that has it's flexible enough that it's easy to read, to write, but it's not so rigid as well, which makes it easier to be reading. I'm a pianist, I also a composer, I make experimental music, free jazz, and I found that as a career path for some time in my life, realized it wasn't exactly what I wanted, ended up going to software. Brazilian, as I said, woman, I transitioned while living in Ireland, and also I'm married to my wife. She's the best person in the world. She's here. She's also happy to be Puerto Rican. And the title of the song comes from A Music of Changes, is a song by John Cage. He's the avant-garde American composer. I really like him. Like as I said, music is important to me. Something that I should keep as a very active hobby. I like this this poem by him is from a book called Silence, and he deals a lot of changes and impermanence, and he's very influenced by Zen Buddhism. So what he's saying is, I have nothing to say, and I am saying it, and I spoke it as I did it. Well, originally I am from São Paulo. That's a city, a huge city in Brazil. It's the 12th biggest city in the world, has a population of 1 million people, and has a very strong development market. It has a very strong startup scene, it has a very entrepreneurial culture, has venture capitals, has more startups, medium startups. And there's a lot of amazing tech talent there as well. A lot of the best developers I ever worked with were developers that I worked while I was living in São Paulo. And I work in quite a different fields. I work in the government, doing some software for tackling the housing crisis. I work in admissions to CGIs. I work in some different startups. But then I think Brazil has a problem. That Brazil has a very serious problem I can see here. Brazil has a very long story of the transgender community. They are very it's estimated that it's a very huge population, but it's hard to get exact numbers because obtaining legal gender recognition in Brazil is really hard, so they don't really keep track of the numbers of who is transgender. And outsiders of Brazil, foreigners, usually they have a more stereotypical view of Brazil, but they think it is an accepting country. There's a accepting country regarding to sexuality and gender identity. And that comes a lot of it from, for instance, Carnival and sort of celebrations that compose what it is, the mentality of what people think it is Brazilian culture. Of course, there are a lot of part of Brazilian culture, but there are celebrations and there are events where the LGBT community does have a space and it can be more extroverted. But that happens in that slot, in the carnival, in that sort of celebration. In the day-to-day, Brazil is really not accepting of people that are not cis and not straight. It's a country that has a big problem with transphobia and homophobia. And, the transgender population in Brazil, so I was saying, has a lot of problems. The TGU, which is the transgender organization, they have this project that they map trans workers around the world. They don't get all the numbers because they usually need to count more with what is in news and things like that. But since they started the project, they've been mapping since 2008 until 2016, they recorded around 102 murders in Brazil. That makes Brazil being top of the list of the country with more trans murders in the world. And then, like, if we see like cultures, the whole of Europe, they have 112 in the same period. That makes Brazil having a high murder rate that is 27 times higher than what it is in Europe. And then according to ANTRA, which is the Associação Nacional de Travestis e Transsexuais, 90% of the transgender women in Brazil are working as sex workers. And that is really hard to have access to the regular job market in Brazil. It's really as a trans woman. This is getting slowly better, but it's still a huge majority. It is immediately associated with sex work and it's very discriminated. I was saying that the other place called Associação de Travestis e Transsexuais. Travestis is the term that usually, if you are ever searching for information about trans women in Brazil, you're going to come a lot about this term travesti. It comes from before, since I was saying we have a long history in Brazil with trans women. It's been always very present, it's been present since I grew up there. You see a lot, but the population. But usually they're going to be referred by this term. It is a term that I don't particularly like because it has a pejorative meaning to it. It's trying to be reclaimed, like kind of the same way as queer has been reclaimed to abandon the more pejorative connotation. But I don't think it works exactly the same way, because while queer, it was accepting of the existence of queer people, but it was the meaning. Travesti has a different meaning, which is you're not a man, you're not a woman. So and doesn't happen. The majority of the travestis actually they want to be identified as trans women. They are not non-binary, so that's end up denying what they are claiming for their own identity, and that I don't believe it's the same trying to bring back reclaim a term from its pejorative connotations when it's a term that denies the existence of what it's trying to define. And then well. Given the facts, it's really hard being gender non-conforming in Brazil. I grew up in this environment, you see non-gender non-conforming people, you see how it is, and I learned to suppress much of my non-gender identity. When I was a teenager, I started exploring my gender identity. I realized that I couldn't fit into living as a male anymore, and I started to address that. I started being more feminine, I started dressing in feminine outfits more, I started that letting the way I represent myself when I was a beer. I started wearing makeup, I started doing that, I was experimenting myself to find my own gender identity. And that had a big backlash, like that was really not deemed as acceptable inside of the society. And then by realizing that when I was started expressing my own womanhood, it would be fatal, it would be like something really hard for me to be dealing with. In Brazil, I became closeted. I decided for me myself, I assumed for myself identity, I'm like, okay, I'm trying to become closeted, and that's identity that I have. So it would be something that I started seeing as like, I don't have a lot that I can do with it. That's something I'm gonna need to live with it, it will be too hard. I thought that at the same time, if I'm working out, I need to, even though that's a big part of me, a lot of other parts of me I wouldn't be able to live with it. So, there was not a lot that I could be able to do. So that's something that definitely, so living there was hard for me. It was a constant struggle for me on my mental health. And I ended up deciding that a lot because of that, this feeling that I had no escape on where I was living, I would rest from it to my grave. So well, the way I did it, I met a lot of countries that I researched the different immigration laws, I researched about how the job markets would be, if it were interesting for me to be joining this job market. From them, I got the list of the ones that are more appealing to a culture that I thought that would be more fitting and then would be better for me to be living on. And systematically, every time I would see some job that had the profile of what I was trying to go, I would apply to the job. And then in the middle of that, I got getting really close to moving to like lots of different places with different languages. It was until finally I ended up getting a job in Ireland on a company that I did a few of some Skype interviews. I visited Ireland, did a few more interviews, were able to get a job that was interesting, and then it also applied to what was interesting in my career. So the first job was in Aflone, it's in Westmeath, that's because it was in Ericsson that I was working, and then Ericsson has a software campus in that place, it's in the Midlands in Ireland, so it's small. And it was a big cultural shock for me, from Rio de Janeiro, like absolutely huge city in Brazil, to is more town in the Midlands in Ireland. I ended up liking it. After some time, after the culture shock got smaller, I enjoyed the time there, but it's extremely different from what I was known. And then that's something that I also, after going out of Brazil, it became a bit more clear for me. Was like the tech world likes its stereotype, especially the idea of like the nerd stereotype, and how it usually people do identify with the geek stereotype on the office and on the culture. And that stereotype is excluding. And then it does not exclude Latina immigrants. They're not part of this common thing. You don't find, as in movies or in the long media representation, a startup founder, a story of a geek genius, of like a math nerd that is Latino. It's not something that is common. But this impact, like that people do identify that this job is with a certain identity that's created and very influenced by a media culture that is excluding of our identity. So, also doesn't help that in Ireland, the representation of the media community is really bad. It's bad existence, it's a subject that is mostly avoided, if it's talked about, it's only on the news and it's very liberal. And on that, like, also, I am a white Latina, so then sometimes people forget as well that I am an immigrant. And sometimes I heard a lot of comments about like immigrants and jokes saying that they're coming here just to find jobs and this sort of thing, because people forget that I am one of those as well while talking to me until they realize, oh, I shouldn't have said that. And one good thing about Ireland is improving a lot in LGBTQ rights. Like, recently the gay marriage was approved by there, it was by a referendum, so the majority of the population voted for it, which is a good sign. It has a very modern gender recognition law that was passed as well. And while I was founded in Brazil, I couldn't save the transition, and that was preventing me from that. Like, it was a consideration that would keep creeping on my head, but as I said, I already kind of savaged myself. It's part of me not being closeted here, and that's what I'm gonna need to do to survive. I made preconceived ideas of that I couldn't act upon that. So, moving to Ireland slowly, I started realizing, ah, here, this is the safest place. I started seeing, even though it is also a minority, it would be safer to be a minority. And it would be able to like, end up losing a lot of preconceived notions of like, okay, if I actually do it, that's what's going to happen to me. And I was able to become confident again, get my confidence, and think, okay, so I'll be able to be positioned and live how I want to live here in Ireland. Which then I also ended up finding in the tech world that the tech, this same stereotype was talking. He's also cis and he's also male. And then he's also included to the things that now people started receiving me as. And then we were not seen as a regular engineer, like they are the exception. And then, even though, like, when I was perceived as part of the boys, so part of it is the regular, stereotypical view of the soft engineer. And then, even though I wouldn't feel like belonging, because I knew I wasn't part of that, it's how they would identify myself. And it had a big difference, of course, and then the way they identify myself is more close to what I actually feel. And one thing that is clear for me, for instance, is when I was perceived as a man, if I was correcting someone, I had a project, I had a code review, or I was in a meeting, and I was being a bit more critical of a project, that would always be celebrated quite easily. And then as a woman, it's so easy to people get offended and be like, I'm crossing the border, and people think I am being too aggressive or too menacing. And then, it's funny because I wasn't perceived like, people perceive more, a bit more that I was part of the community, even though I wouldn't feel like it at all. And now I feel I can relate so much better to whoever is my coworker, to whoever I am in the community, because I got more confidence, I'd be able to be myself, I'm thinking less of how I'm acting, if I am trying to be passing as a man, if I'm trying to be perceived that I am, I can just be myself more, and I feel like it's easier for me, it's easier for the empathy as well, like I do have more empathy for the people, so I for my side, the personal way of having dealing with people, I find a lot more easier. But then on the other side, people see me more of the edge case there, not that much of the mainstream of what is a software engineer. So they don't recognize that it's not on the same level of how these personal relationships are going now. And then, like, just to end, like, on my experience, I think I can add some tips of things that I think that really help and that can make, like, you and your job and really make it being more transparent. One thing, like, if you have HR discrimination policies, please include gender identity. Even if you have a kind of umbrella discrimination policy that somehow you are including gender identity there, make it very clear. Because when someone is in doubt, when someone is dealing and struggling, it is really reassuring to be able to see there that it is embracing gender identity in those forms. And then another thing that I found really good, the company, so inside Mentor, I'm working, they have a transition guideline, and I found it really good. Like having documents that saying, oh, okay, together with the HR documents, like if you aren't going to transition, how to be. If you're going to take sick days because you're going to some medical procedure or not, and whatever, like talk with HR, we can discuss also what each gender that you prefer, how we rather us reform other people's of what is happening, how we rather be us helping other people to be educating about what's happening. It's a really good thing. Another thing, in your communication, also in your papers, in the casual situation when you're talking to people, try to avoid gender and sex essentialism. Like, it's a mindset that should just be abolished, and try nothing boys with boys, girls with girls, or like certain behaviors, or because of certain things, or certain classes of identities of people, they naturally can do sort of thing. Just avoid the mindset. And respect people's gender, what pronoun they're going to use, how they're going to be addressed. If you're in doubt, it's okay to ask, and then from all respect, it's the best to do. And well, have gender inclusive platforms, it's best for everyone, no matter how things are, like it is just a better situation. And here are the references, case anyone's interested on the stats that I was saying. And yeah, thank you.